Praise the Lord. We've been talking about what do you do when your faith runs low. And we established the fact that faith is the only thing that God has guaranteed us as his children that we live by. If anything is going to happen, if you're going to assess all that God has, it's going to be by faith. There is no other shortcut. Which means we fast by faith if you're going to get anything by fasting. We pray by faith if you're going to get anything by that prayer. Everything we do has to, because the Bible says anything not of faith is sin. Praise the Lord. And anything that is sin is not acceptable. In fact, it's not presentable before him. It won't even have access to his presence. So we need to know that this faith is vital to our existence. It's vital to our personal existence. It's vital to our Christian faith. And it's vital to us bringing glory to God in what we do. Praise God. If I pray for you and I expect an answer, it's faith. You pray for someone, you expect an answer, that is faith. But the Bible warns us that we have this treasure in an earthen vessel, in a vulnerable vessel. He says, so that the excellency of praise and glory can be to God. That is to tell us that there is no man that his faith cannot run low. I didn't say that can be without faith. But you see, we also saw the various ways in which the manifestation of low faith is discouragement, loss of vision, conflict of will, sinking, so many ways that we have examined. And of course, we also saw human examples, biblical examples, case studies of people who are strong men of faith. In fact, right from Abraham, the father of faith, we saw their low points. But today, when you look at the heroes of faith, their name is still in the book. So it is not that there come a time that you just find it difficult to pray. It does not make you less a child of God. There comes a time when you find it difficult to actually believe God for what you are standing for. You are thinking that, is this worth it? You want to, in fact, sometimes you tell yourself, maybe it's not the will of God. That is not a faith statement. Because before you demand it, you know it's the will of God. Because if it is not in his will, it won't even drop in your spirit. And if it drops in your spirit, you know if it is not the will of God, you won't say it. If you just see somebody else's wife and you like him, and you say, I want to marry her. You don't know, you know you won't even ask God to help you. Because you know that is not the will of God. But you are single, like Victor, and you see a beautiful sister, and you want to go and fast. No, you don't have to fast. Exercise faith. Praise the Lord. Have you been telling you they've been fasting and seeing vision? There is no vision. They don't see nothing. They only see that. Open your eyes. Watch and pray. Praise the Lord. And so we've seen all these challenges, and we've agreed with all those things. But today, I'll make attempts to bring out those things that God has revealed to me by his Spirit, what we can do so that we remain on the cutting edge. What we should do so that we'll be on tangent and will not fly out of tangents. Praise the Lord. So Spirit of Grace, I thank you because you gave me these words and you gave me opportunity to teach your people. I ask, Lord, Holy Spirit, that you give understanding to every simple heart and magnify the word of God in our life. Let every low faith, let every fear be broken. And let your people arise again in faith. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. The first thing you need to do is humble yourself. Humble yourself. Humility is what makes you in the first place to acknowledge your weakness. The proud never believe they have a need. And when they have a need, they don't believe there is somebody who can help them. They exist in their own world. Be humble. Humility helps us to acknowledge that we are not sufficient on our own. That's what humility does. That's why we have to be humble. Look at the example. One person in the Bible really epitomized the word of humility. At a point when he was full of himself, he said, "Is it not me, Nebuchadnezzar, who has won and conquered all these nations and go? Which of them could have stood against me?" The Bible says, at that point in time, he became an animal. After, you know, they were feeding him. So after a certain time, the Bible says, when he came to himself, he said, "Of a truth, power and everything actually belong." The Bible says, the moment he acknowledged that power and authority, everything belongs to God, he was restored. He would never have been restored if he never acknowledged that he's not sufficient unto himself. When he became an animal, he couldn't restore himself. So no matter how low you are going, no matter how back you are falling, no matter how deep you have gone, the hand of God is sufficient. It's long enough to reach you wherever you are. But he said, "Call unto me and I will answer you." He said, "Come to me and I will come to you." It takes humility to acknowledge that where you have been, the pedestrian where you have been, was not by your power and it was not by your might. So when you acknowledge that something brought me up to this point, it is called the grace of God. This level of faith I'm able to exercise is the gift of God. The Bible says it is the gift of God so that nobody should boast. So if today I discover I am not praying the way I used to pray, I am not doing, I can hardly hold on, I find myself compromising. Yes, it's a state of low faith. It doesn't make you less a child of God. But what do you do? Acknowledge and humble yourself. James chapter 4, verses 6 and then verse 10. James 4, verse 6 and 10. "But he giveth more grace." He has already supplied grace. But when you are in a state of low faith, you need more grace. He said, "Wherefore is yet God resists the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble." Remember that word grace. Remember we said last week, grace is what faith is what makes you to take off. You believe and you start to pursue. But you get to a point in life where you become weary. Travelers become weary. Faith doesn't carry you from the point of weariness. It is grace that carries you. It is grace that carries you. When grace takes you above that challenge, you discover yourself again. Because at the point of weariness, it is a tough period to begin to talk about faith. In fact, I don't know whether you visited a Christian brother, a Christian sister, and you are telling him this, and this, and he say, "I know." Say, "But you don't understand." What the person needs at that point is grace. Verse 10. "Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up." No matter how low you have run in your faith, humble yourself before God. He's the one who gave you the gift of faith in the first place. No matter how low you have run, if you humble yourself before him, he will lift you up. He will refill you. Praise the Lord. 1 Peter 5, 6. 1 Peter 5, 6. "Humble yourself, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time. Humble yourself. You know, it's a different thing when you humble yourself and God humbles you. When you humble yourself, you get plenty things from God. But when God humbles you, he disgraces you. So what we shoot for most of the time, don't go and pray and say, God, humble me. God is not out to humble people. But when people stand, Herod did not humble himself before God. By the time God humbled him, worm ate him up. When Nebuchadnezzar failed to humble himself, God humbled him. And when he came out, he said, me, nobody can tell me again that God is the Almighty. Me, head grass, for how many years? I said, wait till now, no, you never know anything. So if anybody they talk, he say, you don't know this God. The time he dealt with me, I understand. Now I know. But you will not get to that point in Jesus' name. Praise the Lord. So we need to humble ourselves. Praise the Lord. Pride makes people go down. Humility brings people up. The way up is the way of humility. Praise the Lord. The second thing we need to do, or we should do, as appropriate to you, is build yourself up again. Build yourself up again. What did Jude chapter 1 verse 20 say? Jude chapter 1 verse 20. But ye, beloved, building up yourself on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. I don't know whether you've got into, you know you have need to pray. But when you consider the things you want to pray about, you consider the magnitude of the thing and the factors put together, your mouth is heavy. It looks as if you just want to just pray for prayer. I don't know whether you've been there. You know, people are very spiritual. I'm just Pastor Faleti, so permit me. Don't go back and sleep. He says, praying. He says, building up yourself in your most holy faith by praying in the Holy Ghost. Why? Because the Bible says, the Holy Spirit is the one that will do what? Help our infirmities. He says sometimes we don't even know how we ought to pray. That means even though we have faith, we don't even know how to exercise it at that point in time. Not that we don't know what we want to pray, but we don't know how to pray. He says, but the Holy Ghost will help our infirmity with groaning that cannot be understood. So when you don't know, and you know in such situation, even to start the tongue, to start the praying in the Holy Ghost, you go drag. But bet me, by the time you do it in 30 seconds, 1 minute, you are flowing. And at the end of such prayer, see how you come out. You come out as if it wasn't you that entered weak. You come out stronger, bolder. Build up yourself again. Pray in the Holy Ghost. You see, when you are alone and you don't know what next to do and the situation is overwhelming, you have put all the scripture. You know, sometimes we try to describe things to God. We have thrown his word back to him. Just start praying in the Holy Ghost. Because sometimes you just say, look, Holy Ghost, you just need to help me. You see, one of the bane of Christianity and productivity in Christianity is our lack of seeking help and assistance from our very present help in times of need. We are too full of ourselves. We neglect the place of the Holy Ghost. In fact, sometimes I want to sleep. I say, Holy Ghost, I'd like to pray this night. So make sure that you put me in tune of what I'm going to pray about. Many times I don't have what I want to pray about. Sometimes I'm so tired and the whole place, I say, Holy Spirit, the way this night is, you know what I want? I want to sleep. I don't want to wake up by 3 o'clock. If I can wake up by 4 o'clock, I will appreciate it. Holy Spirit, you know I'm tired. And I'll wake up by that 4. I won't wake up by 3. I take the Holy Spirit as a very present help for help because I know I need help. You know, instead of some people to do that and go to sleep, they will say, oh, I need to sleep. They will be thinking of, they will sleep. And then in the next 1 hour, they have not slept. Then they start to have a headache. Me, immediately I talk to the Holy Spirit like that. I'll cover my head expecting that he will give me sleep. And truly I sleep. I have suffered lack of sleep, not because I want to do anything at the night. But when I discover that, what unnecessary burden I carry, because I can't take it to the one who will take it away, I cease worrying. I cease worrying about little things. Praise the Lord. Build up yourself. 1 Corinthians 14, verse 2 and verse 4. 1 Corinthians 14, verse 2 and verse 4. For he that speaketh in an unknown tongue speaketh not unto men, but unto God. For no man understandeth him, albeit in the spirit he speaketh mysteries. Verse 4. He that speaketh in an unknown tongue edifieth himself. But he that prophesieth edifieth the church. Now, this was talking about the gift of the Holy Spirit. And there was a contention. Which one should people pursue? And they were trying to give it example that there's no big deal. You need to speak in tongue. And you must know that it's for your benefit. And you're ministering only to God. It's between you and God. That's why Paul was saying, what if I come into the church? And I started singing, and I want to pray. And I said, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 2. Hiya kalababa santa yibos. Who pahidesh? Mane! 2 Corinthians 2, 4. Imahali prokojo. Then somebody will say, will I not look like a barbarian? Maybe a Pakistani has come to preach who does not understand English. So they will say, in fact, what if a new person is in the church? You're wondering. He said, don't even try to speak in tongues as an instruction to the people if you are not going to interpret. He said, however, desire the very good, the other gift. He said, desire prophecy. He said, because he who prophesied edified the church. Now, that's where those things is. But he said, however, he didn't say speaking in tongues is of no value. For you to be able to even prophesy well, you need to be able to speak in tongues well. Because until you have it inside, haven't been filled. You know when you say you edify, it means you build yourself up, you become full, ready to yield, ready to pour out. So these are what you do behind the door. Or when you're praying here, of course you can pray in tongues. Because every time you do, you are building yourself up. Praise the Lord. Number three thing you need to do. Ask for help. Ask for help. In Matthew chapter 14, verses 30 and 31. But when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid. And beginning to sink, he cried, saying, Lord, save me. That was Peter. All of them thought what was coming was a ghost. But Jesus reassured them. He said, it is I. He said, oh, if it is you, tell me, make I come. And he said, come. The storm was still there. And he stepped out of the boat. And the Bible recorded that, and Peter walked on water. He said, but when he saw the wind boisterous, he became afraid. There are times when you set out in your most holy faith, ready to face anything, but some messages, some distractions, and some reality will almost make you duck out of the place. I don't know if you have had to go and visit a brother or a sister. You just thought maybe just had fever, and when you get there, you get to know what his medical condition is. You look at yourself from toe to head. Look again, you look again. You say, am I sure? I know the bishop, but if I pray for this guy, where I go? That's exactly what happened to Paul, to Peter. From that point, when they say he started to sink, it's the same way by saying his confidence left him. And you know, the Bible says anything where you do, without faith, he sin. It won't work. So sometimes some people come to visit us. The prayer they even pray, when they see the situation on ground, they just pray so that they will say they are Christians. And that's why nothing will happen. But when you get there and you see the situation, say, God, thank you. God, you have brought me here. And since you brought me here, you better deliver yourself. I need help. What should I do? That's why you see people get to something and they will just say, get me a oil. He was not thinking of it before. Get me communion. He was not thinking of it before. Do this. He was not thinking of it before. But he will seek help. He asked for help. And what happened? Verse 31. And immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand and caught him and said unto him, O thou of little faith, wherefore didst thou doubt? But the good thing about it is, when you ask for help, check out anywhere people had asked God or Jesus for help. He may call them later to explain and ask them, what's wrong with you? Don't you understand? But the first thing he does is he resolves the situation. Ask those who were on the IC. He said, they that have traveled on IC, he said they've seen the wonders of the Lord. He said, when the sea begin to toss and everything, as a sailor, they know all the books and all the things they told them. They started to lighten the ship, cast the mast, do this. Yet, the ship was not steadied. And they know that if these things still continue like this and there was nothing else we need to do, it's either we bail out or we assume shipwreck is imminent. You see, when they done all they knew to do, when they got to their wits' end, they say, they call unto him. And the first thing God did was he answered them. He delivered them. He caused the storm to cease and caused them to arrive at their safe haven. God is never going to ask you, you don't know, say, are they here before? It's not man. There's no time you will be late to call him. The only time it is late to call God is when you don't call him until all the consequences come upon you. There is no time you will call God that he will say it is late. You know why? God has to be just. Because if he begins to answer you before you call, then somebody else is going to answer. Say, why did you answer him before he called? So even two, if me too are no call, why will you not answer me? That's the way God is. Ask for help. Ask God for help. Every time you get to your wit's end, remember, there is a strong arm called grace that will always be stretched out to you to take you out of that low point, to take you out of that distress. You might be of little faith, but when you call him, he that is of great faith is going to stretch forth his hand and help you out. Whenever you call, he will answer in the name of Jesus. I said he will answer because that's what he promised and that's what he will do in the name of Jesus. Father, we give you praise. Now, we look at, I said ask for help because only those who ask for help get back to the shore safely. The mute gets drowned. Only those who ask for help get back to the shore. Even if somebody is sinking and is doing like this, people might think he's sinking, he's swimming. But when he asks for help, somebody is going to dive in and save him. But if he doesn't ask for help, the water will send him out the next day, drowned. So don't be mute. A closed mouth is a closed destiny. Praise the Lord. The fourth thing we can do is get a refill or reload your rifle. Get a refill or reload your rifle. What do I mean? Hit the word again. Hit it. Search the word again. Because the Bible says, In Romans 10, 17, he said what? So then, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Faith cometh. Keep coming. Every time, as I'm speaking now, you are developing confidence to do certain things. You are saying, so I can actually get back. So I can actually do this. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. That's why I tell people, when God releases a particular grace for a particular season, you better rise on the wave. If he says this is our month of flourishing, you better be ready to flourish. You better be ready to flourish. And he said this is your season of favor, you better believe that wherever you go, nobody is going to deny you. Those are the kind of months when you hear that this is your season of favor. If you have applied to somewhere before they deny you, you know that yes, they are in trouble. This, because this month has come, because this grace has come, when I go, they don't get choice. Who bond them? You need to ride on grace. You need to ride on grace. You need to refill. It's a faith cometh. It keeps coming by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Where did your faith start with? When you received the gift, it began to build it. We didn't see Jesus of the flesh. We know Jesus of the Bible by the Spirit of God. It could have been Shakespeare's textbook. It could have been Macbeth's story. It could have been the man who saw tomorrow. Nostradamus. It could have been any sect. But the God we serve, he started by introducing himself in a way in which it is incontrovertible and in which no other being can lay claim. Creation. That's why I know that I am serving the right God. That's my infallible proof that I'm serving the living God, the creator of heaven and earth. I have not seen anything or any sect or any God anywhere that lay claim to creation. And all he said, I am still seeing it. The man who saw tomorrow just appeared, just like Elijah appeared. And he disappeared. So that's why our Jesus is not another story. He's who he claimed to be. So you heard that word. Faith building you. And you know what? You are not even capable of developing faith. You are not even capable of believing in Jesus. The Bible says it's the Holy Spirit that convicts you and convinces you in righteousness. That's why I say as many as are marked to be saved. We are a special breed. We are the select few. Praise the Lord. Get a refill. That's why I keep saying it in this house. Please, it's good to come to Bible studies so that you can back yourself up. It's good also to come to Sunday service. But it is not good if you are not a wordite. If you don't love reading your Bible. Any church where they've taken the Bible out of your hand, run for your life. We are not in the era of, in my church, they say, our pastor say that if, what did the Bible say? On what is your faith built? So Paul said, oh, ye foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? Who deceived you? Did you start in the spirit and you want to end in the flesh? When I came to you, was I expounding myself? That's why Big Daddy will tell you, when you see miracle without the word of God, say you have seen magic. Magic exists. Magic exists. So if you want magic, chicken, but you want miracle, let the person share the word of God first now. Praise the Lord. Get a refill. You can always get a refill. Praise the Lord. Number five that you can do, stay in the will of God. In the time of low faith, there is always a conflict of will. In Matthew chapter 26, verse 39, verse 42, and verse 44, Jesus took some prayer team members, like Sister Uzoma, Brother AK, Brother Brume. He carried them. Say, make now come. Matthew chapter 26, verses 39, 42, and 44. He carried them. Like I carry them now and say, we need to pray over this thing. And when they got here, they were sleeping. All of them were sleeping. They were telling you that they go one meeting for morning and go. Jesus looked at them. He just left them. And he went. The Bible recorded that he went further and prayed. Father, if it be your will, if it is possible that this cup roll over me, however, not according to my will, but as let your will be. He said it three times. There was a conflict of will because at that point, his faith almost failed him. He ran low. When he saw the weight that he had to carry, the humiliation, and he says, Daddy, can we renegotiate? But you have to stay in the will of God. Revelation 12:11. Revelation 12:11, please. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. And they loved not their lives unto the death. That is the clincher. The third part. Everybody can claim the blood of the Lamb. Blood of Jesus, in fact, is a reflex now. And by the word of their testimony, it's not my portion. I know that I have divine health. I have these things. But when the pain refused to go, when the swelling refused to go, when the growth failed to disappear, when the money failed to come, are you still in the will of God? Do you love not your lives unto the death? Because those who say, if I die, I die, they never die. When Esther got to the point of, if I die, I die, she did not die. You know why, as children of God, no matter what we are going through, we must remember. He said, nothing that we will ever go through that is peculiar to us. He said, it has happened to something, and our Father is aware of it. He said, all we need to do is stand in the midst of it. He said, right in the midst of that, our challenge, it will make a way of escape. So when you step out of the middle of that challenge, what you are seeing is not a way of escape. You just parrying it. When you come back, it's still there. It will make a way of escape. Why should I remain in the will of God? The Bible says, many are the plans and designs in the heart of a man. He said, but the counsel of the Lord, only that will stand. No matter how you think it could be done, if you did not utter it, you will not launch it. No matter how alternatively, beautifully look, you think it should be done. If God does not utter it, it's not going to launch it. We need to say in that His will, because He will always come true. You may not know how, you may not know when, but He will do it as He has said. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. You have to stay in the will of God. Whenever we have conflict of will, it depletes our faith. Just imagine, you don't have good strength when you are not focused. Well, I think Abinadis, or is this what God, or but this is what I would have want, this is what I would have loved to do. This is where I would have loved to go. This is where I would have loved to be. I know that if I stay here, there's a chance, but it may take time. But let me do this. Pray. If this is what God said, that second alternative, you can bust it. You may not know why now, but you know later. And you'll be glad and give God praise for it. Praise the Lord. So you must stay in the counsel of the Lord. And you must stand in his will. Praise the Lord. Praise Jesus. I think I have about 10 minutes more. Wherever we stop today. Praise the Lord, and we'll finish it because I think I have a few other points. The sixth thing you can do is to listen to the voice of the Spirit. You know, at the point when your faith is low, you really don't know which direction to turn in specific. At the point when the faith is low, you may not even know what actually will I do. Isaiah chapter 30, verses 20 and 21. And though the Lord give you the bread of adversity and the water of affliction, yet shall not thy teachers be removed into a corner anymore, but thy eyes shall see thy teachers. Verse 21. And your ears shall hear a word behind thee, saying, this is the way, walk ye in it, when ye turn to the right hand, and when ye turn to the left. After all, Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth. And Jeremiah 7:23 says, you know, the Bible is sweet. But this thing commanded I them, saying, obey my voice, and I will be your God, and ye shall be my people, and walk ye in all the ways that I have commanded you, that it may be well unto you. And another scripture says, when you don't know what next to do, he said, at that point, you that do what? Jeremiah, he said, you will hear a voice behind you saying, this is the way, walk thou in it. You need at a time. There are times when you need to stand still and ask God to speak. But the major challenge is the pressure that we want, the things we want to achieve. We have some options of what we think God should say or how he should say it. But of course, because now you've gotten to your wit's end, why not just listen to what the Spirit is saying? Because it will always be right. And I will close with this, number 7. Then I'll take the last 5. Next week, Tuesday, God's plan in our life. He said, seek and take counsel. When your faith is low, you just find yourself doing things. You are not vibrant. You are not doing anything. You just know that, yes, seek and take counsel. It's not enough to seek counsel. You have to take the counsel. Praise the Lord. Why do you have to seek and take counsel? Because sometimes the counsel you receive may not look like what you expect. There's a beautiful story of a leprous general. His name is called General Naaman. He must have been a good general for an Israelite who is a slave girl in their house, a little slave in their house, was helping madame in the kitchen. And were just, because they've allowed her to talk, so they are beginning to warm up to her. I say, maybe he saw them saying, when you drop his food, just drop it. You know, you don't have to touch his table. You don't have to touch his chair. Because even though he's a general that is winning wars and bringing trophies, but the Bible says, but he was a leper. And of course, lepers, they are not found in the congregation of the normal people. So, you know, I say, all these things, what would they do? It could have come to an end, though. So what do you mean? Ifoga go go, Ifoga will go to the man of God in our village, where I come from. Say, all these things will be done. And when you read the entire of that 2 Kings chapter 5, this little suggestion, the king of his own town now wrote to the king of Israel. That's why now say, now one, if now they look for war between us and you, you for kuku come with and fight us. This kind of request that you say that I should cure your general, where do I have the power? The king of Israel tore his dress. And then the man of God heard Elijah. And he said, what happened? Tell the king. He doesn't need to worry. Send the general to me. And when the general came with all his, and the Bible says he came with all his entourage and all his people. He said, when they got to the gates, when they got to the compound, the man did not even allow them to come into the house. Elijah sent a message to them. He said, what's the name of that guy that inherited leprosy? Gehazi. Say, Gehazi, go and tell them that I'm busy, but you should just go to that our river where pig the bath. Make him just dip himself 7 times. And that's where they can go. The man became furious. Why? He left at the counsel of a slave girl. Faith in what a slave girl said. He was highly expectant because it wasn't a small journey. He involved kings of nations. But when he got there, the instruction was not commensurate to his status. He became very furious. And he said, even where we come from, better river day. So let's go. When I get back home, they will hear from me. And his lieutenants came to him and said, if it pleases my Lord to listen to us, sir, what if this man have said, give this, give this, give this? Wouldn't you have given it? What if this man have said you should do something great, up to even pledging things? Wouldn't you have done it for the sake of this thing? So what's the big deal? If he said you should drip 7 times, deep now. Let's see. Before, okay, what will you tell the king? He asked me to dip 7 times. I refuse. Let's go and fight him. Say, what if you have dipped? You for dip first. Then if the leprosy no go, then we'll take the war. Say, okay. Like one preacher said, so when he dipped the first one, I said, now they can't. Before he finished dipping the first one, he dipped the second one, third one. When he reached the fifth one, he said, look at this. These people does. They want to humiliate me. They don't know me. I'm General Naaman. Hey, Jesus. They will know that a general has entered this nation. He dipped the sixth one. When he didn't see anything, he said, and you who told me to obey him? So you wanted to see my humiliation. All of us will settle it. In fact, you had. And then when he dipped the seventh time, he came out and was cleansed. What cleansed Naaman was not even the instruction of the prophets, nor the water. It was the counsel he chose to receive. When you receive counsel, it will work for you. And that is good and godly counsel. Because what the prophet said had no meaning to him. Where they ask him to go does not befit his status. But actually what his status was looking for was right in those instructions. He could have gone back. He has the authority and the power to go back in his annoyance. But what happened? Because he received the counsel of his lieutenants. How much of your pastor's counsel do you receive? Your group leader, your fellow sister, your husband, your wife, your children, or you are just the all-knowing that is beyond counsel. The she that must be obeyed. In the multitude of wise and godly counsel of a truth, there is safety. Let's rise on our feet.
If you know these things, happy are you if you do them. Thank you for listening to this message. We trust that you have been blessed. Come worship with us live at TREM Channelized House, 99 Kofo Abayomi Street, Apapa, Lagos, Nigeria. Our service time is 8 a.m., 10 a.m. on Sundays.